So while you're still finding your way back to your seat, I will continue and tell you something about our next speaker. Our next speaker is Mon Amour, who is known as a vocalist, a composer, and music producer who contributed her sound to some films that you may know, also to some games that you may know. She is going to take us on a journey today through 5 decades of listening, playing, writing, recording, producing, and storing music and sound to hopefully engage us and show us that we can also venture into technology ourselves to produce our sound and live out our creativity. So please welcome her to the stage.
Okay, cheers guys, thanks for showing up. So I'm Mon Amour, as you see, vocalist, composer, and in the end, finally, audio artist. I was asked not to do a super nerdy games audio lecture here. So I thought I would go for some more general information, and I also take you back in history, but very fast, and I promise I'll get fast to the facts that may be interesting for you to take away to, if you're considering yourself a career in the games audio, or if you are musicians thinking about how to expand your abilities and and design yourself a profession that and make a living of that, which I found always a very attractive idea. So okay, let me check. So that's better. All right. So I started out quite early. Who am I? I'm one of these young people here in the poster. So you see some young bands, beginning of the 80s in Hamburg, in the punk wave, post-punk scene. And back then I was able to hold a microphone and to sing and to entertain maybe on stage, but that was about it. And use pen and paper to collect my ideas, which I thought is also something that's fair enough. You can do that and stay in this position, but if you want to stay in the long term, I recommend to expand these abilities a little bit. So this very fast historic view back in these times where technology was very, 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 very different to today. So we were recording basically on vinyl, which has a comeback now, even on MC, which is like music cassette. And CD was like the new digital thing back then, mid of the 80s it started. And much later, I found myself being a producer, sound designer, and even working as an audio designer in games, which means interactive audio, non-linear composing. I found this a very utopic thing back then, if you would have told me that I would do this one day, because I'm not from a super technological background. Like the boys, who were always equipped very early, they had the tools very early all the time, and they were like hanging out together, and it was quite normal, not for me, and also there were not so many women when I was super young, interested in hard, amplified rock and roll music. So maybe as singers, but nothing else. So how... How was this even possible that I ended up even on the GDC, which is for me like it was a very proud point in my career. And this is a little, just a glimpse into my studio I have today. Some analog and some digital gear, as you see. Yeah, how was this possible? So of course the basic requirement for everybody who I would say as a musician you can be, you're an artist, but also you have to position yourself in some market, and to make a lifetime happiness and a living from this, you need really, really a big interest, a passion, even an obsession in my part. I can only talk for myself. Also, I have to tell you right now that my career is not at all a very standardizable career. I was rather starting out as the antithesis of somebody who would be a product in a capitalist chain of profit, which is the music market also, as everybody knows. But in the 80s, you were like the rebel, you were anti, you were totally... The idea to make money or a profession about it occurred a little later to me. But this passion for music meant also that you have to be able to find other abilities and some talents that are maybe unique, that position you on the long term in this kind of market. Computer games didn't exist back then, the times I'm talking about now. Yeah, of course, this was also a great motivation. I always hated to be, after finishing school and quitting university for history studies and sports as a teacher as fast as I could, and as soon as I found out that this is not for me, just kill it, and this is something I never regretted, actually. But so I think for me was really the freelance existence was right for me. And I like to design my day myself, and I know when I'm good, what time of the day. And I'm. If you are very dedicated, yeah, this is maybe. And I think in the whole games audio, there are not many employee roles open anyway. Not in Germany, some more in the U.S. And basically, as a sound designer, composers are hardly like employees of some companies. You are always the outsourced partner, and so I have to know about this. But back then, it was really, really like generating the whole thing while doing it. The very beginning, I mean, thinking about technology and music and audio, I thought about what socializes a person from the early ages is, of course, the human voice. So sometimes we use already, that was the technology that was available when I was a kid. The radio actually had a great fascination. And the right thing here, the Grundig, I mean, that looks for you maybe like from a museum of antiques, but this was in a musicless time where not everybody could download everything all the time. It was a rare thing and find the right sound, actually, like the progressive, interesting rock music. You would have really to ambush for it. Once a week, you could find maybe the right program. Is something that nobody here can think about, I'm sure. Yeah, and this was my something like this I was using for listening to the records I found. But this is already generating and sculpting airwaves, because this is the profession too, I could call it. So a flute is a very old, I think it's considered the oldest instruments of humankind, actually. So every kid gets it. And this was my second. By the way, all these photos with this blue silk I just did 2 days ago with my iPhone, and I own all these instruments. And this is still considered kind of normal for a girl, like playing nice acoustic guitar and stuff, and just being the musician. But hey, here you see the first machine. My parents, they owned a machine just like this. And this was the first experience to produce music, was playing the stuff with a microphone, making nice takes, checking is it okay or not, like press play, record and stop, that was mainly it, and balancing a level. This is already the first step into music production. This is like right, and I already loved that back then. So, and role models, why do I have role models here? I remember myself being totally anti-role models. So do you have a role model? No. If you are young, you don't want any role models. You think it's not interesting, but hey, I tell you, it's better to have some cool other women, girls going into these like unknown areas that are like occupied by the guys so far. If there is nobody around, it's much harder. So if there is people around, like get together, stick together, and really exchange your information. That's what I can give as an advice. So that was Patti Smith, was obviously the first woman who was really not not the singer on stage jumping. She was the boss, she was in charge. It was her lyrics, she was the poet, and she was tough and strong, and she just did what she wanted to do. And that hit me as a 16-year-old like a club on my head, I tell you. So she was really cool. Another inspiration. I'm talking about inspiration because it's very important to sometimes the right sentence sinks in your head and changes really your life, or watching these movies. Like, I have three movies in my life. One was Clockwork Orange, where the audio track was absolutely groundbreaking. This was the way, if you talk about audio visual media, then Stanley Kubrick is a director, absolutely important, because the music was always a very, very, very strong element. And here you had Walter, later Wendy Carlos, I think that is Wendy, sitting in front of a huge Moog synthesizer wall. That was really amazing to see. And she was creating this groundbreaking soundtrack using Beethoven played by Moog synthesizers, developing the sound, absolutely important person. And this was all in the head, stuck in the head, because still we have no computer games, nothing of the like around. Second film is Eraserhead. If you want to learn about the power of audio, watch this movie with headphones and learn about this amazing work David Lynch did together with Alan Splatt, the sound designer. They were working with scissors on stereo tape back then. I think they worked 3 years to create the soundtrack that consisted only of weird noises, layers of noises. And yeah, and the third movie I have to tell you about is of course Blade Runner, this classic. That was also a great inspiration. And I thought, I want to do something like this, but I don't know how and when, and later it all came together. And here you see not Blade Runner, this is the city of Shanghai in Kane and Lynch 2, actually. So you see, choosing a good choice of a handful of elements, be it visual, be it create a style. So you don't cook a delicious meal from 15 ingredients, you choose two or three or four, and then you have a style, and maybe after some decades it becomes cult and you have follow-ups in other media. Yeah, of course, this is an image you see, this is kind of the style established, well established, and the soundtrack really, really helped to it. So this is like too short. I'm not playing any sound to you, I'm not showing any movies to you. If you want to listen to all this stuff, you have to check the internet, because it's just not enough time to, because music is a time medium, we would need 1.5 hours. So, okay. The second inspiration was also, of course, the music scene I came from, early industrial music culture, which bands like Einstürzende Neubauten or like Throbbing Gristle were working on a kind of anti-music rather than music. And this is, that was like Cozy Funny Tutti, one of the like core members, also working with the, also working with tape machines, with early Roland stuff. And it was totally evident that she was not like a singer, that she was one member, like the four very important artistic contribution. So that was Cozy. So yeah, and all these bands and these films I was mentioning, they created for me the strong desire to be at a certain part of my career, being more than a singer waiting to be signed by a major or independent company, always like sticking to this role that was kind of prepared for female musicians, which I found really boring. So that was my first 12-inch. And this was still the stuff I'm using, very normal. We were recording on two-track tape, so the fourth role model actually is another great friend of mine is rock photographer Ilse Ruppert. She was super courageous. She was traveling the whole world, and she was handling her Leicas, and she was also developing her photos herself. So we met at an early stage in my career. Ilse is actually here. Here we go. So, yeah, that was just an example of Ilse was sitting on the speaker in the Markthalle in Hamburg while doing this photo, actually. So, back then I was able to be a part of this kind of elitist community of musicians who were able to go into a professional recording studio because it was super expensive. These machines here, they almost like fetishized character because they are so expensive and so good. And I have to say it's right that they were so expensive because in the crucial parts, audio recording tools are expensive to make a good sound. It doesn't mean you have immediately to spend 20,000, but there are some, but I will get back later to this checklist what you should have. Back then, this was a kind of elitist world. And of course, the sound engineers were men, the producers were men, the record company bosses were men everywhere. I mean, my musicians were men. I choose them because I like them, because I loved how they played. And so there's nothing wrong about this, but the decision makers were also men. And that got really, yeah, this is the first key moment. Was like end of the 80s, I had a record contract with RCA. Back then they don't exist anymore, like other major companies too. The whole market has drastically changed. But okay, I had a second LP in my contract. I was sent to England for a lot of money, and I ended up in the studio being told by sound engineers, when talking about my vocal sound, for instance, no, it's not possible. So I just heard something that I really liked. Oh, no, but I said, but I just heard it. Oh, we didn't store it. It's not possible. So that really started to piss me off. I'm sorry. So they were expecting that you just held your mouth and just function in a kind of system. And the second sentence is in this. A famous musician said that to me, who was my producer back then. I'm not saying who it was, because this sentence really haunted me. And yeah, now you're gonna have a word with the master of the house. That was because I was like working on the side with a guitarist who was around, and we were figuring out some really interesting little motifs. And the main guy, he just disappeared and came back after some hours, and he said, oh, this has all to go away. I'll show you now what should be there, and now you're gonna have a word with the master of the house. And said, okay, this is enough for me. And then I decided, yeah, this aggression will not stand. I have to get my own gear. Because in the end, so if you are the artist signed on a major label and like budgets are being created for you, why shouldn't you have the say about how you sound, how you look, and so on? They don't like that. I mean, maybe today is everything different. I'm just telling you, like the power I had to create inside myself to reject this and to go my own way, and there was no way around this. So that meant the horrible world of analog and later digital audio production in its core meaning. So this surface here was the surface of the Atari machine. This is created my freedom, my independence. This relieved me from having to hire mostly male programmers who would program me little sequences for 1,500 marks a day. Because I thought I was not able to do this, because this looked just so horrible. But if you look, if you have this thing, if you buy the thing and you have to sit in front of it, and after 10 minutes you find out that it's really, really easy to create a sequence, to play a sequence, because you're a musician, so you're able to play something maybe, you have a MIDI controller, you just play your sequence, you press start, stop, record. And you have little sequences here. It was so easy. The 3 days I was circling around this poor computer I bought in 92 or something for 2,000 marks, this little machine here. I had three of them in the end. I kept this very long because the program that was running on it, this fabulous sequencing software, CLAP Notator, because this later helped me in the games audio that is non-linear, helped me so much, because this is not based on a timeline. This sweet thing here creates loops and loops, loops of different lengths, and open in an open continuum and not timeline-based, like in the film. So maybe that's why I could kind of intuitively fit into this game's audio way of thinking. Okay, I try to be fast. This is my beloved, wonderful hardware sampler in Sonic. I had three of them too, which has 16 MB RAM memory. It came with 4 expandable to 16 megabyte, not gigabyte. But you could work very fine. It had an awesome effect section. I sold it a year ago to Italy for $1,000. And this is my gear. I sold this last year, but I have to show you just this beautiful, almost. A SCSI cable. Okay, I'm not whining about that these times have passed. And who is that? Kanye West, using the same machine, ASR and Sonic. So you see, developing your own sound means you have to find the instruments you love. It can be musical instruments, but it can be samplers, computers. You can even develop. You have to find your own way and see what really helps you create a good workflow. And it has to be sexy for you. You have to like to switch it on. Okay, so that was my DAT. This we mastered in the 90s, even still on DAT, which is a digital tape format. Really cool. Still, you can use it. I have some recordings from the 90s. They just wandered into a movie by Elfie Mikisch. It will be shown in May. And I was listening to this stuff I mastered on this old gear. It still sounds fabulous. So I think the good idea is really find out what you really love and integrate it. Of course, there are some general requirements you have to match in concerning sound quality. Of course, you can't be totally out of that system. But then again, you should be free to find what you really like. And this is my recording console I still use. Also very funny, if people have no idea about the technical sides, people come to my place and, oh, do you know all these buttons, all these buttons? And I say, yes, I know all these buttons. But the truth is, there are single channels. All these buttons are identical, but for 24, so you master one of these channel strips and you know the whole mixing desk. It's really easy. But don't tell everybody, okay? So yeah, and this, actually, this synthesizer was one of the pillars of my games career. This vintage, wonderful analog synth, Wasp. It looks like a Wasp, it sounds like a Wasp. Helped me because the sounds are so unusual. And when I decided I had to do something else than being a singer and waiting to be signed to a record company and put out music and hope that this sells, because if it doesn't sell, what do you do then? Look for a day job? No, not me, thank you. I wanted to do more. I wanted to stick with sound, with noises, with electronic music, with instrumental music. And so this humble machine really helped me to develop this possibility, because it is so unusual. Because when I decided, yeah, you have to expand your professional model a little bit. Should I go for the dance music? Okay, all these guys are since 20 years developing beats, experience. This is not my way. So I try to find to make new traces in the freshly fallen snow and dare to come up with some really weird, strange sounds. So, and this machine really, really helped a lot. Actually, today, maybe you know that there are new neo-analog synthesizers will kind of copy these oscillators you see here. It's nothing else. But this is a modern machine. It's also very cute. I own one of these now. And it has no recall. because it's not programmable. So you have to make decisions and record them and have them on audio, okay? Which is a very important point, making decisions, being able to stick to an aesthetic idea and say, yes, this is what I want and I'm taking it from here. And no, I've seen people really dying in front of their workstations because they can't decide what they want, because they can change everything all the time. So I come from these tough times where once it's on tape, you have to live with this, okay? It's not so bad, actually. It's quite good. Oh yeah, Katalog für Musiker. When I did these first steps and people started buying my music for money, I got sent this catalog for musicians, which means it came from Just Music sending me a 300 pages catalog where I should buy many, many devices. I didn't even know what they were about. And I was sweating. I thought, oh, I don't have this. I don't have this. And this I don't have too. Do I need it? I was so unsure of myself. But this was a period I came through. So now I just throw it away and I buy what I need to buy if I think I need more gear. Oh, yeah. This was also a big motivation. Everybody, when I met people, when I was making my way into like commissioned work, oh, you're a musician, you sing, eh? This was everybody. This is really crazy. If you're a woman, people say, oh, you sing. I said, no, I don't sing. I'm a programmer. That took some years, but now I say, yeah, I sing, sure, because I still do. So now that healed, this wound healed, and the more secure you are with some projects. Yeah, and this was actually the crucial point, was somebody brought this game into my house. Very early computer game, the Blade Runner game. So I thought, there's something like computer games that my strange music will fit in. And yeah, it was also very hard to find. It was almost impossible to find to break into that, because these jobs were not advertised, and there was a chance once in a million. But this chance happened that I could become the audio designer for Terra Tools, and now to venture into non-linear music composition and composing, where these. Yeah, where all of a sudden it made sense that I was using this nonlinear notator sequencing program. Great interest for noises. That came also from like Neubauten and the bands I was mentioning to you, who were really, really venturing deeply into the effects of noises and noise layers on our minds and our brains. So there's not only music, there's more to it. There is also voice recording is very important. You need atmosphere, you have music, you have noises, and everything will be modulated by the audio engine of a game. So it's good to be courageous and also take a look at audio engines of the people who program them. Yeah, to get an idea what will happen to your sound, you have to know what do you deliver, in what form do you deliver, in which formats do you work. But nobody expects that you will learn this from scratch, from zero, because this has to develop, I think. So yeah, that was the first game I did. I did the whole music and sound design. I'm really proud of that. It was a kind of not masterpiece, but for me it was like the first game. I was responsible for the whole thing, and yeah, exactly. So if you are really up for seeking a career in games audio, you have to be ready and open to. I really don't know. Are there musicians here, or game audio designers, or game developers who are open to audio questions? So from everything a little bit. So yeah, you can. It depends really on your preferences, on your personal preferences. Are you more the musical composers, or almost never are very, very close to this coding side? As a sound designer, yes, you have to face, even use a middleware like FMOD or something, and It depends on how far you want to go in a specialization. This is funny. I met them. So Limbo, I think people know the game Limbo, maybe. Yes, it was quite an independent hit. So Martin Stig Andersen was the sound designer. And we met in San Francisco. And funny enough, he also had the same kind of advices, like using the unusual stuff, like obsolete software, antique hardware in a way, or like vintage synthesizer, something like this Wasp machine, a lot of distortion, but of course in homeopathic doses. I use a lot of distortion. In Limbo, the little character, the steps of this little boy, they consist of three or four different files for each step that are modulated by the engine. That's what Martin told me. And a little bit of the distortion here and there that also was modulated by the engine. Very, very. This, about these steps, I could hold a 3-hour lecture. I'm not going to do this now. Yeah, so I ended up in Kane and Lynch 2 and all this. This is really strange how the whole my whole history kind of led to this work, where I could add like 300 minutes of just noisy soundscapes, noise layers, like dreamy, distorted stuff, where my whole past would make the basis for being able to do this. It's really crazy. This is how determination maybe. Oh, okay, this is shit. And yeah, I mean the interesting takeaway stuff for you is like, okay, if you want to produce music, hold your ideas. Of course, you need a computer. And if I wrote a good audio interface, of course, a computer is a computer. Doesn't have to be the latest machine. But audio interface is important because that makes the sound. That changes the analog into digital and back. This has to be a good quality. A program. I'm not sponsored by any Logic or Pro Tools or Ableton or whoever, so you have to find your basic software, the digital audio workstation software. And I recommend also a stereo editing software for editing your stereo sum once you got your mix ready. A MIDI keyboard does it. This doesn't have to be expensive, but good speakers and good headphones, because this is what you get used to. You get used to listen to trashy laptop speakers. Don't do that. Don't do that. It spoils the whole experience. And also a microphone has to be good, if possible. Back then, this all would have cost really thousands and thousands. Today, you have much better possibilities. Okay, that's what I was trying to. Yeah, you want to be a service provider or an artist? You want to express yourself, or you want to do commissioned work and make a living, or both maybe in the same time? This is what I'm going for, which is for me the greatest fun and the most. I'm already. It's half an hour over. Oh no, it's more. Oh my goodness, get a showreel. Do the things the others don't want to do or unable to do. That was my father who said that. Okay, I'm really willing to give you all these slides. That's really too bad. Can tell you a bit about the rights you are generating. As a musician, as a composer, you generate authoring rights and master rights, and I'm like gone. Yeah, okay. I'm so sorry. Didn't know that is so. So much in such a short time. So, yeah, thanks so much, guys. If you want to.
Thank you, Mona. Unfortunately, we don't have any more time for questions.